You had a good week, I hope. Great time of worship this morning. And I trust that in the next few minutes, you'll catch a heart for where we want to go on a little journey. And Tim's put together this little three-week series, which we're kicking off today. And I trust that you'll be really excited and grab something that really not just whets your appetite, but is fundamental and instrumental in allowing God to shape you into the person that he wants you to be. So shall we pray? It'd be a great place to start. Father, we thank you for this new day. We thank you for everything that you give to us. Lord, in these next few minutes together as we go on a little journey, I pray and ask that your Holy Spirit move amongst us wherever we're from, whatever our background is, whatever our understanding is, whatever part of the journey we're on, Lord, that you would be increased in our understanding, that your presence become ever more real. Father, we pray evening for that there will be sudden awakenings, that the lights will come on for us as to who you are and the centrality of who you are. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Amen. Now, I have a little bag with me here this morning. Accessorize. Okay, this has nothing to do with Mother's Day. This accessorize, although some of you may have received something like this today. What have we got in here? Well, who come on, hands up. Whoever, who knows where Accessorize is in town? That's more men than women. Okay, so maybe you've not been too accessorized, but how many people kind of buy stuff to accessorize perhaps the way they look? Now, I just have to look across the room this morning, and there's a whole bundle of stuff out there that's accessorizing you, isn't it? So we got things like... This is a nail file, just in case. Okay, one of those things. Nail file, perfect. To beautify nails, by what I understand. Here we got things like this has no hold on me. Come on, Tim.
Yeah.
And we've got other things in here like bracelets, and all these are accessories. And you know, I look around the room this morning, and I see some people have got brooches on, and some people have got fancy scarves, and other people have got watches on, and jewelry, and some women have got makeup on. Maybe some blokes too. But there's the room is full of accessories. Is that fair to say? Is it a fair comment? And what are these accessories for? Well, the definition of an accessory, a thing that can be added to something else in order to make it more useful. A thing that can be added to something else in order to make it more useful. Now, I guess for each of us here, there's a much wider scope to that understanding. But an understanding that our lives are filled with stuff and things that we add to who we are or to the things that we do in order, we feel often, to make them perhaps more enhanced or more beautiful or more worthy or whatever. And things like Things like this here. This is just a little USB, what do you call them? USB stick, thank you. USB stick. I mean, it's amazing, isn't it? You can get more information on this thing than enabled them to land a man on the moon. Isn't that amazing? The amount of information and technology that can go into this small little device now is greater. These things we find so useful and handy to our, you know, we've got apps for everything. To be honest, I hate it. I don't do it. Wrestle with the whole stuff. But there's apps. If you want to know about an app, here's the man to go and see. Phil Lachem. But, I mean, how many people download apps on their laptops, on their desktops, on their phones, on their iPads? Come on. What for? The rest of you? Sorry, everything. We've got all sorts of apps, haven't we? We've got all sorts of apps which we add to our lifestyle in order to enhance it, to make it go faster, in order to give it a greater memory, because we've got the basic thing, but we want to add to it in order for it to be better, to perform better, to give us more information, to give us information on the go, because we want it now, we don't want to wait, we want it now, or even in fact, yesterday would be better. All of these things. You know, I've got here, this is a bit more exciting. It's a sprocket. Oh, hello. Oh, there's an app for that, yeah. And another sprocket, motorbike. Off a motorbike. Now, an RM85. Oh, have I lost you? A Suzuki, known as an RM85, comes as standard with a 14 tooth on the front and a 47 tooth on the back. Did you know that? That's its standard performance ratio. Now, to enhance the performance of the bike, one can change the ratio of the sprockets. You could put a tooth smaller or a tooth bigger on the front, even two if you really want to push it, and you can go up or down on the back. And what that does is it changes the performance of the bike. And that can be for all manner of reasons, perhaps just the way you ride the bike, your rubbish, and in order you need to try and enhance your performance to get you improved, or perhaps you're riding a different kind of event. If you're riding up and down loads of hills, you want to have a different gearing than if you're riding on the flat of a sand and just going flat sticks. All of these things, these are bolt-ons. Bolted on, serves a purpose, and we take it off. Bolted on, take it off. And I guess all of us, with our cars that we drive, the motorbikes that we ride, all these sorts of things, that we will have a number of bolt-ons, the homes we live in. How many of us have bolt-ons in our homes? Yeah? TV, it's a bolt-on, isn't it? It's in the corner of the room, it's up on the wall, whatever, wherever it's positioned, to enhance our whole experience of life. All manner of bolt-ons. And you know what a bolt-on is? Normally a performance-enhancing part that can be removed and re-standardized as necessary. Something that is added to something else, again, in order to make it more useful. And that got me thinking, as Tim had asked me to kick off this week. And we're beginning a series, a little mini-series, looking at the centrality of Jesus Christ. Jesus, the center of it all. It's the reason we're here this morning, isn't it? Jesus is why we're here this morning. Or maybe there are some here this morning who have come for other reasons, and that's great. I hope that in the middle of that you meet Jesus. But I want there's a little bit of a challenge here, but I want us hopefully starting today and look in the next couple of weeks is to realize that Jesus is enough. You know, all of these things. I mean, how many of us have downloaded an app and after 2 weeks, maybe 2 minutes, realized that's just useless. And that's even more frustrating when you've paid £1.99 for it. And it's not a money back. There's no money back guarantee. How many of us have Googled and searched for this thing which is really going to enhance my lifestyle or this part of my life or our family experience or whatever, and we purchase it. We go onto eBay or Amazon, and Amazon because it's Prime, and you get it next day and it's free, and all of that, and it arrives, and we plug it in or we put it on, and it's like for 5 minutes or for 10 days, it seems to perform a task that is useful, and then it's like, oh, it's not quite so, not quite as it what I thought it might be. But as we look at the person of Jesus throughout the course of time, even before time began, he has always been enough, is enough, and will always be enough for us. And I guess for us to be so excited and consumed by the person of Jesus, that here's the thing, that as we go to work on a Monday morning, that the person of Jesus living in us is enough for every situation we face. That we know his love for us sufficiently that no matter what comes our way, no matter the type of conversations we have, Jesus oozes out of us in a way that's challenging, in a way that's absorbing, and so forth. You know, interestingly, I mentioned the sprockets here, but interestingly, some of you may or may not know, I also ride a motocross bike nowadays. I sit on it and go around the track, not as perhaps it should be ridden, but I love motocross. And we've found in the last couple of years, as we've kind of positioned ourselves within that group of individuals who love motocross, there's some very interesting encounters. Because it seems, as one person said to me, that those things are poles apart. And when we first started going along to the motocross track, and the funny thing was that they encouraged Micah to start and said, look, we'll allow Micah to race, because normally, you see, he should be practicing on a Sunday morning to enable him to be able to race legally in the afternoon. So they said, actually, what we'll do is we'll delay the start slightly in the afternoon so you can come do your 2 laps minimum practice required by law in order that you can race. So that went down really well with certain individuals who was like, well, it's like not only did there was the slight frustration that they had to wait, but then when they found the reason why they were waiting, because someone had to be at church before coming to ride a motorbike, was like, but you know what? Just in these last couple of years, the conversations and the respect and how that's grown has just been exciting and amazing. I was away with one particular guy last weekend and just talking about Jesus to a guy who's like, this is not his world. And God has just positioned us, and I want to encourage us, and hopefully in these next couple of weeks, as we look at the centrality of Jesus, and we focus on, look, he's just called us to be who we are, but to know that he's enough. We don't need all the add-ons. Do you know what? Our church is a great church. I think we have great, amazing worship. We're involved in some great stuff, but that's not what saves people. It can be attractive, but it's like an add-on. Those things can easily be discarded and we get back to the standard item, and it's all about Jesus. Fundamentally, through and through, when all is said and done, it's all about him. So I want to challenge us, I want to encourage us to take a look at, is Jesus enough for you in your workplace? Is Jesus enough for you in your marriage? Is Jesus enough for you in your workplace? Is Jesus enough for you when you're raising your kids? In that he is the all-sufficient one. He's promised his presence. He's promised wisdom. He's promised to stand with us every step of the way. So to be encouraged by all that he can and wants to be in our lives. So that's where we're going in the next 2 or 3 weeks, looking at the centrality of Jesus. Now we're basing that around Ephesians chapter 2, verses 19 to 21. And that's going to come up on the screen. I'm going to read that for us. Now, the therefore is there for a reason. Because just prior to this, Paul has been talking about the amazing wonders, again, of the grace of Jesus. How he has saved people from who didn't have the benefit of the heritage of being a Jew. And it was like these aliens. Now, here's the thing. All of you in this room this morning are all aliens. We are all strangers in the land. And what the gospel has done, and Paul was encouraging them, is that all of you, Jewish history, Jewish benefit, and the rest of you, all aliens, we have this amazing truth that Christ has died for all of us. And he gives us that same inheritance. He positions us with the same authority. Now, therefore, in understanding this amazing gift that he gives us, now, therefore, you are no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, having been built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Jesus Christ himself being the chief cornerstone, in whom the whole building being fitted together is growing into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you are also being built together into a dwelling place of God in the Spirit. This morning, I just want to, in a few minutes, focus on Jesus, the cornerstone. Jesus, the cornerstone. Now, I've got a picture here. Oh, not that one. Anyway, it's coming. Now, this is part of the Western Wall in Jerusalem. It's not what looks familiar as part of the Western Wall. Some of you may know the Western Wall, particularly today, as part of the Wailing Wall in Jerusalem. It's the holiest of places, effectively, for Judaism today, in terms of where they come and they pray. They place prayers in the slits between the stones and so forth. But this, thank you. This bit of wall here, this is part of that same bit of wall. It just happens to be many, many feet below what is visibly seen today. And so there are tunnels that run under the ground. But this is part of that same Western Wall, part of that Wailing Wall in Jerusalem. And a capstone, we don't recognize it the same way in today's modern building practices. But a capstone back in the day, so to help us understand some of the imagery that Paul is using of Jesus, the cornerstone. A cornerstone was a massive block used effectively to set out the corners of a building. More often than not, they were the biggest. However, not always. But more often than not, they were the biggest. And effectively, these cornerstones set the precedent for what took place above. They encapsulated an area. They were so heavy and so large that they served as part of the foundation for what then took place above. Now, this particular stone here, so it's trying to understand, this would have been familiar part of Jesus's viewing. Okay, and those who've been to Jerusalem back in the day Paul and the like, when he's talking to individuals, talking about a capstone, here's a stone 45 foot long, okay, 45 foot long by approximately 12 foot wide, and they reckon it's about 14 foot deep, weighing in at just under 600 tons. It's a big stone. And to this day, the experts still do not know how they got the stone there. Because there was no modern day machinery. It's reckoned about 250 tons is the heaviest weight that modern day machinery can lift, a stone like that. So there was something going on, some great feats of strength going on in order to shape the stone and then get it into that position. But here's the imagery. Paul talks about Jesus being the cornerstone of our faith. That which sets out, lays out of all that's yet to come. Can you see the power in the imagery? If you're stood in a place like Jerusalem and you've been through there, and they're talking about cornerstone. They're talking about a cornerstone that is so massive, so influential on the rest of that whole build. And Paul is saying, Jesus, for us, for all time, is this very cornerstone. Life is built upon him. He is the essence for all. He is able to equip us in all and for all. Everything we do centers around the person of Jesus. I want to take us just to a couple of other verses in Colossians 2. Colossians 1, verses 15 to 23. Now, you will be familiar with this portion of Scripture, but I hope today you're encouraged by the essence of who it is we're talking about. Jesus, the all in all. So Colossians 1, 15 to 23, the supremacy of Christ. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. For by him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things were created by him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together. And he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn from among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him, and through him to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. You see, once you were alienated from God and were enemies in your minds because of your evil behavior, but now he has reconciled you by Christ's physical body through death to present you holy in his sight, without blemish and free from accusation. If you continue in your faith, established and firm, not moved from the hope held out in the gospel, this is the gospel that you heard and that has been proclaimed to every creature under heaven, and of which I, Paul, have become a servant. That is an amazing, it's just an amazing portion of Scripture. The centrality, the focus in on Jesus. You know, I haven't used him in a number of years, but I have a pair of binoculars back home. And the purpose of the binoculars is to bring something that's far away and seems small and insignificant to right into focus, to magnify it. And this scripture here, I think, magnifies the person of Jesus when it talks about all he has done all from the beginning of time. Look at all the alls that it talks about in reference to Jesus. Jesus is the firstborn of all creation. Verse 16, all things were created by him. Verse 16, all things were created through him and are for him. Verse 17, he was before all things. Verse 18, he is the first in everything. Verse 19, all the fullness of God dwells in him. He reconciled all things, and the gospel is proclaimed in all creation. In no uncertain terms, Paul wants to make the point that Jesus is supreme. He is the most prominent one. He is the one who deserves all the focus, all the attention, and he is more than enough for us. I find that really humbling in a society, because I think my experience of church over the years has been that Jesus is often more of an accessory to our life. He's more of a bolt-on, because we're in a situation, and it'd be really handy now, Jesus, if I could have a bit of wisdom for the situation, and you see, in the natural, we dress, don't we, appropriately for the situation or the circumstances we're in. So, and sometimes, for the wrong reasons, I think we can dress spiritually in order to appease those around us. So we're in a church context. We're here on a Sunday morning. We're at a church meeting. Or maybe we're in a place where there are other church people around. And Jesus is the add-on. Jesus is the bolt-on, because he's appropriate. He gives extra performance, or so we think. He suits what we want just at this time. It's like a scarf we put on and we take off. We feel we need something, so we drop in the old, perhaps the Jesus word, because we're in that environment and it looks good and it feels good and it suits. But then we walk across the corridor into another, perhaps the work environment, and there's the rest of our work colleagues, and because they don't go to church, but actually to mention Jesus in that circle was quite appropriate. And now I'll take off that app and I'll take off that bolt on and that accessory, because now I'm with these people. And I don't really want, you know, I'm a bit uncomfortable with Jesus, all these people really knowing that Jesus is my all in all, that I'm passionate. Like I told one of the guys at the motocross, he says, well, as long as you don't start preaching here, too late. I said, I'm here. But you see, for him, he's gonna see Jesus, and we've had some interesting conversations. But being real, but not just taking off the scarf because, like, I'm now in this environment and I just don't feel Jesus is all in all. Either he is who he says he is, the one that Paul talks about. He's the preeminent one. You know, who is our go-to in life? You know, for many of us, life hits the fan, or there's a bit of a crisis, the kids are throwing a wobbly, whatever, phone, I'm just going to ring so-and-so, I need to speak to somebody. I'm in the middle of this, and kids are throwing up. And they're our go-to person. Well, actually, I fundamentally believe Jesus, maybe this the old adage, you know, Sunday school answer of Jesus is the answer. Maybe that's not good enough for you, but sorry, it's all I've got. That Jesus is our go-to before really anybody else. I think sadly much of our experiences, we better pray about it now, I suppose. It's like we've exhausted every other opportunity. We've exhausted every avenue. Now, okay, I suppose as a last resort, we better pray. That doesn't reflect the kind of person that Paul is talking about. One who is overall, one who created everything, in whom everything belongs. He existed before time. Everything he has created is for him. Even the trees and everything we see around us. We go outside, look at the sky, look at the mountains, look at the trees and the valleys. and the seas, all of those things were created to give glory back to God. And the person of Jesus is He. In my life, I want Him to be that person more and more glorified. I've lived too long. I've messed about too much in faith, with faith. I've had my fair share of add-ons, of bolt-ons, of legalism, of religiosity. Oh, if I do it like this, it'll all work out. What is that? It's a bolt-on. It's all about Jesus. If I get up at 5 o'clock in the morning and read my Bible, maybe for half an hour, I'll become a better person. It's a bolt-on. It's a downloaded app that at some point, very soon, you will probably realize how frustrated you become that it doesn't actually fulfill what you were hoping it was going to fulfill. I'm not saying it's a bad thing, but it's not the thing. It's not Jesus. I mean, didn't Mark Ours preach an absolute humdinger last week about faith and walking out of faith that is real and solid? Faith, having the full weight of our confidence in something. Because we all exercise faith every day of our lives, but putting the full weight of our confidence in the person of Jesus, because He's before, He's been there already. He will be with us, He's around us, He's more than able, He's more than capable. And you know what? Just to shout out Jesus, you know, Tim asked us just before to, can we just thank Him? We thanked Him. There has been many a time where I've found myself in a situation and all I can say is, Jesus, Jesus, because I've got no other words to say. But you know, I think that's one of the greatest prayers we can pray. I have no idea what's going to happen, Lord. I'm in this, boots and all. God, help me. I tell Micah when he's riding his bike, I tell him, ride for Jesus, son. When you're on that track and you're chasing somebody in front of you, remember who it is you're riding for. Talk to Him. Come into that corner and say, come on, Jesus, man. And live it for Him. Let the reality of the presence of Jesus be in everything that you do. Not just a bolt-on, not just an add-on. Let Jesus ooze out the way you are on the track. You see, the centrality of Jesus, Paul talking about the cornerstone, is not some prop. He's not some influence, because the problem is so much of us in church life, Jesus is just an influence. So we like Jesus who gives us a spot of wisdom for this situation. We like the fact that Jesus has healed that person. We like the fact that Jesus made a way possible over here. But actually, when we're done and through that situation, we discard it. We take it off and put Him to one side until the next crisis. But He wants to walk with us day in, day out, that we might know the beauty of all that He has not only done, but is doing, has promised to do in us, and will do into the future. That Jesus is enough. And the longer I've been a Christian, the more I've wrestled with stuff, the more I've become frustrated with programs and Christian apps. If I do this, this will be. Just as Tim mentioned this morning about what they were learning yesterday. It's like type in the right request and out will come the right answer. Life just isn't like that. Life isn't like that with Jesus. But He has promised to journey with us through it all. But is He sufficient? I believe He is. Scripture points to the fact that He is. He's been there from the beginning, is here now, and will be there at the end. And more for me, the simplicity is just putting the full weight of my confidence in Him. That He is absolutely the centralized figure in my thinking. You know, there's a great scripture. When Jesus was being challenged, if you read in Mark chapter 12, they say to Him, what's the greatest command? What does Jesus reply? He says, the greatest command is this, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your soul, with all your strength. Do you know what? Those four things pretty much encapsulate every part of our lives. It talks about passion. It talks about our thinking and our minds. It talks about all the stuff we can be involved in with our strength. What are the things that we're engaged in? We can live them out for Jesus. Are we passionate in our worship? Is Jesus centralized when we come to worship, when we sing here on a Sunday, when we are in the workplace on a Monday, we're having a conversation with somebody. Is Jesus centralized to that conversation? Now, I don't necessarily mean that the word Jesus comes off our tongue, though that is absolutely necessary and essential. But that are the choices that we make, is the guidance that we give, is the wisdom that we provide, is it godly? Is it Christ-centered? Because if it ain't, what is our faith? It's just an add-on, it's a bolt-on, it's an app. Is Jesus central in the way we're bringing up our kids? The way we are with our work colleagues? Do you know what? It's not an exercise for a Sunday morning. Like, it's Sunday, right, I better put on Jesus today. We'll go off and we'll do the godly thing. We'll sing some songs. And then we'll go back home. We might meet somebody along the way. Where have you been? Are we embarrassed? We might be. We might not be. All of these opportunities is what we do. Is Jesus an additive? Is he just an influence in our lives? You see, when we get Jesus centralized, when he is the focus of all that we do, the decisions that we make, the journeys that we take, everything else needs to fall into place around it. Yet so often we can fall into the habit of, this is what we want to do and this is what we're going to do, and we try to fit Jesus in it instead of allowing him to be central, the driving force, the encourager, the motivator behind all that we're doing. So when Jesus says, and I'm about to wrap up, when Jesus says in his response, love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your strength. Which one did I miss out? Mind, heart, soul, and strength. Mind, heart, soul, and strength. It's not about how much we have to conjure up in order to give. It's just in all our activities, in our worship, in our passion, in our conversations, in the way we deal with life. Let Jesus be at the very center. Let the textbook answer. Let the primary school answer of Jesus be the driver. I don't think it has to be so difficult. Because let love be the key. Passion, compassion and kindness. These are all the fruits of what he's doing in us and has called us to be. Let that absolute joy centralized on Jesus be the determining factor of who we are as individuals.